work in this station at night cleaning the boilers, but when they put in the steam whistle, the station master, evidently considering my age and incapacity for the heavy work I was doing, gave me the one job of releasing the steam into the whistle, for which I had to arrive punctually every morning and evening. The very first week of my new service, I noticed that after performing this duty of mine I felt vaguely ill at ease for an hour or two. But when this queer feeling, increasing day by day, eventually became a definite instinctive uneasiness from which even my appetite for mako disappeared, I began to rack my brains in order to find out the cause. I thought about it with particular intensity. For some reason or other, while going to and coming from my work, but however hard I tried I could not make anything clear to myself, even approximately. Things went on like this for almost 6 months, and the palms of my hands had become calloused from the roke of the steam whistle when, quite suddenly and accidentally, I understood why I was experiencing this uneasiness. Shock this brought about a correct understanding, resulting in the formation of an unshakable conviction, with a certain exclamation I happened to hear in the following rather peculiar circumstances. One morning when I had not had enough sleep, since I spent the first half of the night at the christening of my neighbor's ninth daughter, and the other half reading a rare and very interesting book I had come across entitled Dreams and Witchcraft, I was hurrying on my way to relieve the steam, when I suddenly saw at a street corner a barber surgeon I knew, employed in the local government service, who beckoned me to stop. The function of this barber surgeon friend of mine was to go through the town at certain hours, accompanied by an assistant pushing a specially constructed cart, and to seize all the stray dogs who were called a lack of metal tags issued by the local authorities on payment of the tax. He then had to take these dogs to the municipal slaughterhouse, where they were kept for 2 weeks at the town's expense and fed on slaughterhouse offal. If by the end of this period their owners had not claimed them and paid the tax, these dogs were driven with certain solemnity down a passageway that led directly to a specially designed oven. Shortly afterward, from the other end of this remarkable and salutary oven, there flowed, and a delightful gurgling sound, a certain quantity of delicious and ideally pleased fat, to the profit of the fathers of our town, for the manufacture of soap and also perhaps of something else, while, it surely sound no less delightful in the ear, there poured out a fair quantity of useful substances for fertilizer. My friend, the barber surgeon, proceeded in the following simple and admirably skillful manner to catch the dog. He had somewhere obtained an old, quite large fishing net, which he carried on his broad shoulders, folded in a suitable manner, and during these peculiar excursions of his through the slums of our town, humanity, when a dog, without its passport, came within range of his galloping and for the whole canine species' terrible eye, he, without hasting all the softness of a panther, still up close to it and, seizing a favorable moment when his victim was interested and attracted by something, cast his net over it and closely entangled it. Then, pulling out the part in which a cage was attached, he would disentangle the dog in such a way that it found itself imprisoned in the cage. When my friend the net down on the pavement, he spat over his left shoulder and cried out, "Oh, hell, what a time to ring." As soon as this exclamation of his reached my reflecting apparatus, numerous thoughts began to swarm in, and which ultimately led, in my view, to a correct understanding of lust, why there proceeded in me the aforesaid instinctive uneasiness. The moment I understood this, I even felt annoyed at myself that such a simple and clear idea had not entered my head. I sensed with the whole of my being that my interference in the communal life could have no other result than the very sensation that had been proceeding in me all this time. And indeed, everyone awakened from his sweet morning slumbers by the blast of my steam whistle must doubtless curse me by everything under the sun. Just me, the cause of this infernal din, and thanks to this, there must surely flow from all directions toward my person vibrations of all kinds of malice. On that memorable morning, after performing my duties, while sitting in my usual mood of depression in a neighboring kitchen and eating hachi with garlic, I continued to ponder, and I came to the conclusion that if I should curse beforehand all those who are outraged by my service for the benefit of some of them, then according to the book I had read the night before, however much all those still lying in the realm of idiocy, that is, between sleep and drowsiness, might curse me, it would have no effect on me at all. And in fact, since I began to do this, I no longer feel that instinctive uneasiness. Single quote, quote.